climate change is not a tragedy. Climate change is a crime against humanity committed on the part of these oil companies.
These reports are pretty scary, but are they true?
Has there actually been any global warming?
All of us would like to believe that corporations do the right thing. They're not intentionally deceiving us or destroying the world.
If we all work toward the same goal, I believe we can change the perceptions of the American people about energy.
We need you to be an important part of it. Together, we can make a difference.
Did we aggressively fight against some of the science? Yes.
For decades, fossil fuel companies have coordinated what is arguably the most consequential deception campaign in history. And so far, they've gotten away with it.
We have a mountain of evidence showing that they knew for decades exactly where we'd be today and lied about it time and time again.
The state of California is suing Big Oil in one of the most significant legal challenges the industry has ever faced.
The financial liability that the companies could face is, you know, potentially existential. It's a huge threat to the industry, and they know it.
This lawsuit tells a story about how some of the biggest companies in the world lied to protect themselves. But it also does something much bigger. For the first time in history, it could actually force them to pay for the damage.
There's what our street, one street over, looked like in the morning, just flames flaring up everywhere. And then the next day, we got to our lot, and this is all that remained of our house.
Bill Vosburgh is a retired teacher in Santa Rosa. In 2017, he and his wife lost their home to the Tubbs fire.
The fire jumped over Highway 101.
I've been watching an orange glow that I thought you guys had under control, but I'm starting to see like flames flickering.
There's our house down there in the courtyard, and the fire just ripped through here all the way down there, blowing like a storm.
At the time, the Tubbs fire was the most destructive fire in California history.
It was like driving through a mini war zone. The fire had destroyed 5,000 homes here in Santa Rosa.
But the fire no longer holds that title. Since 2017, Californians have lived through 8 of the 10 largest wildfires in the state's history.
The August Complex fire surpasses 1 million acres.
Oh my God. There's like explosions everywhere.
The entire scope of my vision is nothing but ruins.
All throughout the state, the wildfires have been longer, harder, more intense. We had tremendous losses ourselves, but we're one of thousands of people, billions of dollars that these fires have cost.
And it's not just fires. For years, California has been on the front lines of record-breaking heat waves, drought, and flooding.
And I think it's time that we look directly at the sources. The number one culprit is CO2 emissions. Fossil fuel companies play a direct part in the misery we suffered, as well as thousands of other people. The tragedy for me is that the oil companies knew since the early 70s, in the case of Exxon, that burning their products was going to lead to global warming.
In the 70s and 80s, I graduated from college in 1981, ExxonMobil had a very good reputation. ExxonMobil was doing science that was as good or better than any academic group at that time.
That's Naomi Oreskes, a Harvard historian of science who spent decades studying how companies like Exxon lied to the public.
I love this graph because in this graph, we take ExxonMobil's own work. So ExxonMobil scientists created a set of forecasts in the 1980s, forecasting what would happen to climate change in the future. And then in this document, we compare ExxonMobil's predicted changes with other models that were available at that time and also with what really happened in the real world. And one of the things that's fascinating about these data is, first of all, they show that ExxonMobil's predictions were very accurate. The company scientists had a very good handle on what was likely to happen in the years to come.
Dr. Hoffert, is that correct?
We were excellent scientists.
Yes, you were.
At the time, Exxon was also an industry leader in renewable energy, funding groundbreaking research in solar cells. But in the late 80s and early 90s, something changed.
Hello, I'm Gord Thompson. Today I'll be talking to you about a debate that's going on in the country right now, and one in which Exxon plans to be very active.
Something shifted at ExxonMobil. If we look at when this shift occurs, it's at the moment when climate change goes from being a prediction about the future to being something that scientists are saying, oh, actually, this is already starting to happen now, and the world is coming together to try to do something about it.
In 1997, world leaders met in Kyoto in an effort to draft the first legally binding treaty to reduce global emissions.
Mr. Albert Gore Jr., please.
The United States remains firmly committed to a strong, binding target that will reduce our own emissions by nearly 30% from what they would otherwise be.
But behind the scenes, another plan had already been set in motion.
Right now, a United Nations effort is moving toward decision in 1997 to cut the use of fossil fuels based on the unproved theory that they affect the Earth's climate.
By the early 1990s, ExxonMobil becomes part of something called the Global Climate Coalition. This is a network of oil companies, coal companies, automobile manufacturers who consciously and deliberately set out to prevent the United States from signing on to the Kyoto Protocol.
Through front groups like the Global Climate Coalition, the fossil fuel industry spent millions advertising and lobbying to kill U.S. involvement in Kyoto. The Senate ultimately never ratified the treaty. And in 2001, George W. Bush officially pulled the U.S. out. Documents from the State Department later revealed that the administration had rejected Kyoto in part based on input from the Global Climate Coalition. The industry had found a winning strategy, and in private, they were very clear about how that strategy worked.
Okay, so this document, Global Climate Science Communications Action Plan, this is a really good example. This is from 1998. They say the goal of this project is that a majority of the American people, including industry leadership, recognizes that significant uncertainties exist in climate science and therefore raises questions among those, e.g. Congress, who chart the future U.S. course on global climate change.
Scientific evidence remains inconclusive as to whether human activities affect the global climate.
By 1998, climate change is no longer a theory. It's an observed fact. So this is explicitly about stopping the U.S. government from acting on the known scientific knowledge at that time.
They lied. And yes, I was misled. Others were misled.
That's Chuck Hagel, a former senator who was instrumental in stopping U.S. participation in Kyoto, admitting that the industry was lying to the public.
If they had said then, if they'd held their hands up then and said, yes, this is real, could it have been different?
Oh, absolutely. It would have changed everything. I think it would have changed the average citizen's appreciation of climate change.
And Kyoto was just the beginning.
Real question is it dangerous? Is it going to harm people?
Exactly.
There's not a 97% consensus on that?
Of course there's not.
The idea that Bill Nye is just going around saying CO2 is up, therefore global warming is dangerous, we should be concerned, it's not. It's not dangerous.
Look, the air is ugly, it's unpleasant to breathe, but the reality is there's no health risk. We have this kind of air in India and China all the time. No public health emergency.
In the years since Kyoto, Exxon and other industry giants have doubled down on their strategy of using PR to sow doubt and delay action.
Many of these ads were designed in a way as to say, well, the science is very unsettled. We don't really know for sure. Let's not panic. We also know that they funded research programs at universities. They supported workshops and conferences that were designed to cast doubt on climate science. The scale is extremely large.
And by all accounts, their investment has paid off. For the last few decades, efforts to address climate change have repeatedly crashed and burned in the toxic political environment shaped by the industry.
I asked the chair, you know what this is? It's a snowball. So it's very, very cold out. So here, Mr. President, catch this.
All while global temperatures have continued to rise.
Is this the apocalypse? Are we looking for the signs? We had a UFO situation the other day. I found a frog in my pool.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
All of this with the global warming and that, a lot of it's a hoax. It's a hoax.
How is it that we've been having more or less the same conversation for so many decades?
Much of what they did was modeled on what the tobacco industry had done. The same people who had worked for the tobacco industry casting doubt on the science shifted to work on casting doubt on the science of climate change.
But the example of big tobacco may be just as instructive for those who hope to hold big oil accountable.
Committee will come to order.
In 1998, the tobacco industry was successfully sued for their deceptive and harmful marketing. Lawsuits between 46 states and Big Tobacco resulted in the largest settlement in U.S. history. It forced a major shift in marketing practices and dissolved industry front groups. The agreement also had many issues. With little oversight, the money flowed to the states, but not necessarily to addressing the harms of tobacco. But the settlement remains an example of massive consequences for harmful marketing, which California's lawsuit could soon force on big oil.
They predicted with terrifying accuracy exactly where we would be today. And they knew then that if the people of California and America, the world, knew what they knew, it was a problem for their business model.
Rob Bonta is the Attorney General of California. He's currently leading the state's lawsuit against five of the biggest oil companies in the world.
We have presented a very robust complaint, over 100 pages long, that lays out our case in very exacting detail.
The first thing California's lawsuit aims to do is put a stop to the industry's misinformation.
One of the main remedies is stop lying, stop false advertising, stop making false claims, stop deceiving the people.
California's lawsuit also seeks money, a lot of it, to address real damages in the state that have resulted in part from the industry's deception campaign.
We're asking them to create an abatement fund funded by the defendants to the tune of billions of dollars, and it will pay for adaptation and mitigation efforts. Things like clean air centers for the dirty air that they've created, cooling centers for the extreme heat that they've created, water storage to address drought, seawalls to address sea rise.
The California case is so important because, first of all, California is a major oil-producing state. It's the fifth largest economy in the world, so it's much more of a potential threat to the industry. And it also sent a signal to other attorneys general that, you know, the big dog's in the game, so it's safe to get in here.
California's case is just the latest in a wave of similar lawsuits across the country, but it could represent a tipping point.
So if you add up all the states that might file, the financial liability that the companies could face is, you know, potentially existential. It's a huge threat to the industry, and they know it. That's why they're so afraid of these cases.
There are many who question ExxonMobil's commitment because of what was said over 30 years ago, or what they think Exxon knew back then. Frankly, I'm more interested in what ExxonMobil knows today.
The year is 2024. Exxon is as profitable as ever. And even though they invest only a tiny fraction of their budget in renewable alternatives, they have diversified their messaging strategy.
Here's what ExxonMobil knows. Climate change is real. Human activity plays a major role. And it is one of the major problems facing the world today.
Outright denial is still a thing. It has not gone away. But in addition to that, they also have a strategy saying that they need to be part of the solution.
The oil and natural gas industry
are taking action,
investing in technologies that reduce our environmental footprint.
But if you actually look at the budgets that these companies have for these other forms of fuels, it's tiny. 98% of their activities, 99% of their activities are still focused on the core fossil fuel industry.
In a recent statement, the American Petroleum Institute called the California lawsuit meritless and a distraction, and said that climate policy is for Congress to decide, not the court system.
In California, when someone breaks the law, they need to be held accountable and held accountable in court. I don't want to overrepresent the importance of litigation. Everyone who cares about climate change has a role to play.
This was a real tragedy that was really hard to go through. If they had made an adjustment to renewable fuels as early as the 70s, we could be in a much better place than we are right now. But instead, they continued to rake in their billions of profits, lie, deny, delay, so that they could continue to burn fossil fuels, leading to the destruction that we have now. I hope that the state will win against the fossil fuel companies. It would be nice to see some of the money that the oil companies have gotten for profits go into making the lives whole of the people that have suffered as a result of the fires their products help produce.
Hi, thanks for watching, and as always, like and subscribe to see more videos like this one. If you have ideas for stories you want us to cover, please drop them in the comments below.